looking at John chapter number 12 this evening. We've looked at this for a couple of weeks. We started with looking at Jesus coming back by to the place where he's feeling welcome and wanted. He doesn't go to the temple. He doesn't go to any other place but to the place of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, because that is the place where he is welcome. The Spirit of God and the working of God goes in the places where he is welcome. Really, I want to look more, starting at verse number 12. We've looked at some of this, and I'll try not to be redundant, but maybe in about one thing. Looking at it this evening, we see that this is the week that is prior to the crucifixion of Jesus. So we're almost a week ahead. So get our, as we are celebrating it, so it kind of gets us to the place where we can think about what is going on. And the week of prior to Jesus' crucifixion is considered to be one of the most eventful weeks of his life. Particularly, one of the highlights is this triumphant entry as we see him coming into Jerusalem. Jesus, the Son of God, the long-awaited Messiah. It has been over 500 years that it's been prophesied prior to his coming. Brother Doug will talk more about it in a minute. We'll reference back to Zechariah. But it's been over 500 years since it's been prophesied that he's making his triumphant entry into Jerusalem on that of a donkey. And let's just look at verse number 12. The Bible says, on the next day, much people who were come to the feast. What was the feast? Do you know what the feast was? What's that? No, the feast would have been Passover. Passover is coming. And Passover plays a very large part in everything that's happening here this week. And even in the events of Jesus, his triumphant entry, what is happening with the people, that he will be crucified. So all these events around Passover are speaking volumes. Remember, Passover has been celebrated for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And so the Jews, this is something for them that they're speaking of and they're talking of, and they're looking at prophecy, and they're looking at what has happened back in Egypt as God set them free. They know that it is a type of the blood of the Lamb across the doorpost, but they don't understand everything. And we're going to understand a little bit more tonight why they don't understand everything. What was the reason, Brother Doug, that they did not comprehend and see and embrace Jesus for who he was instead of who they wanted him to be? Remember, that's a big factor, that it's who they wanted him to be as we're looking at these scriptures. And so the Bible says, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, amen, they took branches of palm trees and went forth to meet him and cried, Hosanna, or save us, we pray. Blessed is the King of Israel who comes in the name of the Lord. Really, this is coming from a psalm. You're looking at Psalms 118. It's a song that they're singing. It's probably a part of Passover as well, as they're singing these songs. So much is happening here. So Jesus is coming in, and let me just read my handwriting. My printer broke, so I have a lot of chicken scratch handwriting. It's very customary for people to spread their garments on the pathway of royalty. And here they are, and they're waving palm branches. They're saying, Hosanna, or oh, save us, Passover's here, and there was hopes for a Messiah. Really, it's almost like a canopy. Can you imagine Jesus riding in on this donkey? So there's clothing, cloaks on the ground. He's riding over it, canopied over with palm branches. I mean, magnificent. And they're singing, and they're crying, Hosanna! Save us! They're looking at him being the conquering king. And so... the word of God says, blessed is he who comes, blessed is the King of Israel who comes in the name of the Lord. And Jesus, when he had found a young ass, sat thereon as it is written, fear not, daughters of Zion, behold, the king comes sitting on an ass's colt. Now, someone, if you would, turn to Zechariah 9:9. I know we did reference this, but I want to look at this one more time. Realize that here are the people in Jerusalem. They're looking for Jesus to be their Messiah. They're looking for Jesus to come and restore the country to its former glory. They're looking to Jesus to destroy their enemies. They have hope for a Messiah, but they were really blind to really what the mission and the true Messiah was all about. Can I just stop here for a second and say something? When we get away from the Word of God, and we get our own ideas, and we can easily project on God things, we can miss who He is as God and as the Savior. We can look at these Israelites and we can say, wow, how did they miss? How did they not know? Because they were making him to be who they wanted him to be. In Isaiah 44, we read of the folly of the idol maker. The idol maker makes the idol into what he wants it to be. Forms it, Brother Doug. He cuts down the tree. He burns it. Stretches out his rule, Brother Justin. With tongs, he burns. And with skill of tools, he carves. He makes the image into what he wants it to be, Sister Stacy. And the Bible says that God says, man, I planted the cedar and the ash. I'm the creator of them, and man takes my creation and designs it to be what he wants it to be. He's more intelligent than what he designed. And then he turns around and worships it as if it's more intelligent than him. We may not form an idol with our hands, but we can easily form in our minds who we want God to be and how we want God to respond. And we want God's holiness to be like. We can miss the mark just like they did here at his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Someone read Zechariah 9:9. So it's prophesied, Sister Tina. Zechariah is prophesying 520 years before this actually happens. The prophet is prophesying what's going to happen. They know prophecy. They studied it. They know it well. They know the Old Testament, but they forget who the Messiah is. And all the gospel writers, they present Jesus in their own way, but John presents him as God. Amen. He presents him as God. And so here comes the Messiah. Let me get back to John here. I moved my finger and got out of the... Someone read verse number 16 of John chapter number 12.
These things understood not his disciples on the first. But when Jesus was glorified, then remembered they that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things unto him.
Go down to verse number 17, if you would.
The people therefore that was with him when he called Lazarus out of his grave and raised him from the dead bear record.
So John is writing once again after the fact, and he is saying that here are these disciples. They understood not, his disciples didn't understand it at first, but when Jesus was glorified after the resurrection with his glorified body, then they understood. They remembered the things that were written of him. So remember, here it is. It's a week before. He's going to be crucified. He's going to be laid in the grave for 3 days. And so we have a stretch of about 10 days where these disciples, they really don't understand. And it may be even into the 40 days until they understand when they see him resurrected and in his glorified body that they really understand and remember what was said of him and what he said about himself. And so the Bible goes on down to say in verse number 17, the people therefore who was with him when he called Lazarus out of his grave and raised him from the dead, bear record. Here they are, Passover, they're talking about the Messiah. They're looking at Lazarus. There's proof that there's resurrection from the dead. Now remember, the Sadducees did not believe in a resurrection from the dead. And so they hated what they seen in Lazarus. Because Jesus was speaking, even in the resurrection of Lazarus, he was speaking something greater that would be of himself and for every believer who has a conversion, who confesses with their mouth and accepts Jesus as their Savior. It was a symbol of eternal life. And so these Sadducees, they were aristocrats, they were in with the Roman government, they had a very comfortable, cushy job making money. You know how that is. Time has not changed. Folks who have those types of jobs don't like to cause rift. They want to glide through and make it very comfortably. And that's where these Sadducees were. And so Lazarus coming against what they believed, that made them feel uncomfortable and threatened them. So they wanted to kill Lazarus. They want to get rid of him, Brother Doug, because he's evidence. Let's get rid of the evidence. And so that's where we find, as everything is coming, I said to you on Sunday morning that really Palm Sunday is this. It's like two streams coming together. One stream having seen everything that's happened with Jesus and the raising of Lazarus, and they're trusting and they're believing and they're trusting in him as the Messiah. And then there's another stream and it comes, and so these folks are mingling together. And the word is spreading about what's happened with Lazarus. And so as they hear what's happened with Lazarus, they think that he could be the Messiah. But Passover is all about the Messiah and longing for the Messiah, singing about the Messiah, talking about the Messiah. Could this be? And so with all the excitement in the air, imagine how it is Christmas. You know how all that excitement, like electricity in the air at Christmas. Any of you ever feel that at Christmas? That's what it's like. And so here it is, they're coming together and there's talk of Lazarus. And they're talking about the Messiah. They're very angry, religious leaders. So they're wanting to put to death Lazarus. And they're hating Jesus as well. We look at verse number 20. I said to you before that there are Greeks there. For whatever reason they were there, I don't know that we know a solid reason for that, but we know that Greeks are traditionally known as seekers of truth. So as they come, they're seeking truth. And they approach Philip. Why did I tell you they felt comfortable approaching Philip? What's that? Because his name was a Greek name, and he could have lived in the region where they were. He could have been from there. So two different things. They felt very comfortable approaching, wanting to know about Jesus. And as they approach Philip, they say to him, came to Philip, which was at Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, "Sir, we would see Jesus." Philip comes to Andrew. And Andrew and Philip, they tell Jesus. And then we see in verse number 23 that Jesus, he answers. Would someone read verse number 23? This is very interesting in its wordage, and very interesting when we look at what John had wrote previously. So I want to read verse number 23. And you can read verse number 24 as well.
And Jesus answered, saying, "The hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, abide alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit."
All right, so let's look at this word. Jesus answered, and what did he say when he answered, saying, the hour is come. This is very catching to our eye, to our ear, to our mind, if you think for a moment. Because there was another time when Jesus talked about the hour, but it was not come then. You remember when that was? Well, he did talk about that. That's not what I'm thinking.
The hour that no man shall know the coming of Christ.
So he said the hour is come, but what about when the hour was not come? Remember when that was? At the wedding, his first miracle. And John records this that way. Very interesting that John records it that way. That he says, "Woman, what have I to do with you? My hour is not come." All of this referring to the hour in which Christ, the whole purpose in his coming, was Calvary. Was Calvary. He said, "My hour is come. The crucifixion is before me." The whole purpose of why Christ came. Yes, he turned water to wine. Yes, he had a 3.5-year ministry. And yes, he did miracles. But what he came for was to take on the sins of this world, that he may pay the penalty for sin and bring restoration between God and man. How phenomenal that God would do that. And then he says to him, he said, "Except a corn of wheat falls into the ground and it dies, it abideth alone. But if it die, it brings forth much fruit." To think what Jesus was saying. Listen, when we think about one kernel of corn falling into the ground, in reality it dies, but in its life it brings forth much fruit. Jesus was saying this. He said, "The cross will be mine to go to the Lord. I will die, and I will die alone, but another, in my death, I will give much, much life." Wow. He died so that he could bring forth great life, so you and I could know life. If it were not for him dying, no soul would ever go into an eternity with God, but we would all die and die an eternal death. But because he chose to die, amen, Sister Stacy, we may have life and life eternally. Hallelujah. Thank God for that. Amen. That he was willing to give, even if it meant, I don't know if I'm going to get ahead of myself there. He said, "He who loses his life, who loves his life shall lose it. And he who hates his life in this world shall keep it until life eternal. If any man serve me, let him follow me. And where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him my Father will my Father honor." Someone read Let's just, someone read verse number 27. And I know there's a lot we could combine here, but let me just break it a little bit. So I'm going to read verse number 27 through 30. We're going to break it up looking at it, but I think that's the best way to read it, to, if you would. 27 through 30.
As my soul troubled, what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour, but for this cause came I unto this hour. Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven, saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. The people therefore that stood by and heard it said that it thundered. Others said an angel spake to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice came not because of me, but for his sakes.
Amen. Jesus, his soul was troubled. We talked a little bit about this last week. His soul was troubled because he was going to feel the separation from the Father. Something he had never felt before. Something he didn't want to have. And in the separation from the Father, he was taking on the sins of all the world. And he said, you know, If I could, I would pray, Father, save me from this hour. But he said, I know that I came for this cause, for this hour. Once again, he's looking at that hour. He's looking at that time where he gave his life. And Jewish, as we go on down, we find that he said, Father, glorify your name. The Bible says that there came a voice from heaven. And the voice said, I will glorify it, or I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Jewish tradition shares that voices that came from heaven were regarded as substitutes for prophecy. The word glory there means to magnify or to exalt or to praise. Do you remember another time where God spoke from heaven, where Jesus was there? Jesus was baptized, and God spoke, and he said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. You know, everyone saw that. Everyone heard that. They saw the dove like a cloud descending. They heard God the Father speak. But here, when God speaks, the Bible says the people that stood by, was it thunder? Was it an angel? The problem was that when the Father spoke, unfortunately, these people were spiritually blind, but they were also spiritually deaf. Spiritually blind. Sister Stacy, they did not see what was going on with the Messiah. They did not look at the prophecy. They did not take the Old Testament in which they had, Brother Justin. They were blind. They didn't understand. And then the Father speaks, and they are spiritually deaf. I wonder what it's going to be like when Jesus returns. Folks spiritually blind. Folks spiritually deaf. And Jesus, he didn't explain everything. He simply said, the voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. The Word of God goes on down to say, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. Who's he talking about? Who's the prince of this world? What's that? The devil. Satan. And so he's speaking here, and he says there's going to be judgment upon the devil. The devil isn't going to like what's happening on Calvary, and he still doesn't like what Jesus did on Calvary. Listen, Satan tonight is not symbolic. Satan is real. And for every child of God, I want you to know that Satan has been cast out of having authority over your life. He's very real, but because of the work of Calvary, the hour that Jesus was talking about, Satan does not have authority over your life. And he went down to say, he said, and if I be lifted up from this earth. He was trying to explain something to some people who did not want to hear what he had to say. They didn't, Sister Tina, want to believe that Jesus was going to be crucified. They wanted him to take over Sister Beth, a political government, and deliver them from their enemies. That's what they were expecting. This Messiah is going to change it. He's going to build a kingdom which will bring us back to our former glory, and we're going to love it and enjoy it. Can you imagine? We probably get tired of politics in our life. You look and see how things have gone. So those folks were tired of politics. They were looking for someone to come in and take over and do what was right. And Jesus was trying to say to them, listen, I've not come for that. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, he was talking about being crucified. He was telling them that he is going to be put to death. They didn't believe the Messiah would die. But the Messiah came to die. They thought he would be victorious. They thought he was going to set up a physical kingdom. And of this world, there would be no end to it. The Bible says the people answered him, we have heard out of the law that Christ abides forever. And how do you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Once again, they were trying to fit Jesus into their mold. He won't die. But they failed to grasp and understand the identity of Christ. Let's stop here for a moment. Let me say that phrase again. They failed to grasp and understand the identity of Christ. They tried to fit him into their own mold. Prophets have told it for hundreds of years, yet they still missed it. Here are all these people who are shouting Hosanna, and they're excited about everything about Jesus coming. But soon before you know it, when he was going to be hung on a cross, they wouldn't be there to support him or defend him. They missed it. Because they were trying to cram Christ into a mold of their own making and their own mind. Verse number 35. Then Jesus said unto them, yet a little while light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness come upon you. For he who walks in darkness knows not where he goes. John loves this idea of light. And he has vividly described Jesus as being the light. I am the light. And Jesus tells him, I'm the light of the world. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may be children of the light, he says. These things spoke Jesus and departed and hid himself from them. Let's talk about this for just a few moments, and I'll close on this part. Jesus is telling them, listen, I'm only with you a little while. Walk in the light. But they were blinded. Even Jewish scholars, they were blinded. They could not understand. They could never understand who Jesus was. Jesus said, walk in the light. I'm the light. I'm with you for a little bit of time. There's something very, very important for us to be able to say. We're not nocturnal. We need something that is important for our eyes. The most important thing that you need for your